Hallelujah. What a great blessing it is that Yah grants unto us breath or ruach, that we may, as Torah would speak, we may gilad, we may praise Him with the sound of the achlelah, the sounding of the shofar, that His name is excellent, and we certainly excel it above all names, because there is no other name like the precious name of Yah our Abba. There is no name that is comparative. There is no name that gives the greatness of excellence like His precious name. So we greet you all that have joined us via the live stream, that we may hear from our Abba, that He may speak unto us. And don't look for some audible voice in your ozin. We must hear what the Torah commands. He is speaking no other way. He is not speaking but by the voice of those that He has deputized. Very seldom do you see the sheriff of a county or one that has been elected. You may see the deputy sheriff, but you see the deputy, and they are commissioned by the sheriff to carry out His agenda, His mandate, what He commands unto them. And so He has commission in the earth realm today, those that are messengers. And that is why He refers to them as melech. And same thing with the king, the melech. An ambassador, a deputy that speaks by the voice of Yah. And so don't tell me He's talking to you. Don't tell me that He spoke in your ears and you heard. You're not hearing anything. If we cannot hear the Nobi, the prophet of Yah, how are we going to hear Yah? We can't hear the soundness of Torah, the wisdom of His counsel. If He spoke, would you hear Him? What would you do if He spoke to you? Yet there are many that say He's speaking to them, and their attitude never changes. He speaks to you, and there is no trepidation. It's almost like your avat never experienced that. But I do know my Eva. When I knew that I was hiding something, and she would call me, there was a great surge of fear, because I knew I had done something wrong. And to my speculation and being presumptuous, I assumed that she realized what I had done, and there was a price to pay. Even if our natural forefathers caused our hearts to tremble, you telling me that the Most High speaking to a wretched thing like me, I don't tremble? You're flat out liar. And I defy any of you. You're liars. You're flat out liars. There's only one speaking to you, and that's the greed of the God of your vile, lustful nature. He's not showing you one damn thing. It is amazing that people got and they possess this plethora of knowledge when they cannot maintain in the simplicity of instructions of Torah. But they are gaining all these great revelations. They don't have a damn thing. When the simple foundations of truth are not the sustaining pillars of one's life, you don't have a damn thing. So that's why we're silly and full of folly. And our concept of Yah is this vanity and foolishness. I've never seen such a foolish generation in all of my life, and I'm not that old. They're foolish and silly, full of folly, clownishness, and laughter beyond the spectrum of even the registering of the sound of it. It is just folly everywhere, Yisrael. Can I say this to you all? I've never been one of folly. Never liked being silly. Never have been silly. Never have been one given over unto laughter, not even with my issue of 36 years of marriage. I've never been that way. I've never liked it. I've never been a part of it. There is nothing more vile than a silly man, than a silly woman. There's nothing more repugnant to me. I was the type, I would not even speak to someone like that. I would not. I'll just look at them. And don't do it today. And I was out on yesterday to run a few errands. I look at the women today. And I look at what I see. It's sad, especially the women of the dark hue, of the diaspora. What I see, it's dismal. It's appalling. The way they look, the way they dress. Listen, I have physical symmetry. You understand what that means. That my girth is not larger than my shoulders. I have a symmetry where the physicality of my body, if I wanted to put on me a tank top and a pair of shorts, I could get by all day, even at my age with all of my gray showing. You understand? But what I see today, it is appalling. It is a vile spirit, especially among those you of the darker hue. Just like Amos said that they despise, we sota, we hate them that sit at the gate to yacha, to rebuke us, to set us straight, to show us how vile we are. We hate them. Let not the man speak upright, because when he speaks upright, he is ta'ab. He is despised. He is an abomination unto them. We don't want that. And so as Yah says of Ephraim, she is a silly, little stupid Jezebel. And we're silly. I hate it, Yah. I don't laugh with the Achim. I don't play. Never have. It's a time that a nation must be sober. I'm going to teach. Don't worry. And so what I saw yesterday, the appalling, vile disposition of flesh, the way women dress. I don't like to go out that often. But I saw women 350 pounds, and they got, Miss Obama has done one thing for the women, to tell them to show their arms. And they look vile. Stretch marks and the fatness of the stench. Fatness hanging out of their clothing. I don't give them any kind of appeasing look. Don't look at me. I mean it. And I see this vile nature. And you would do the same if you were out there. Believe me. And I say, Yah, what is the mindset of this generation? That a woman has no shame. Mama, I would be ashamed to go out like that. And I'm physical too. I have masculinity. And believe me, if I did that, I would get looks by older women, younger women. They would. But I'm ashamed to dress like that. I would be ashamed to expose myself that way. I would literally be ashamed. And these women are so grotesquely. Same thing with men. Overweight. Their bellies hanging down and they think that they're fine. You're not fine. You have deluded your damn mind to think that that's sexy. It is not sexy. You look like a pig. You look filthy and wicked. I don't give a damn who don't appreciate what I say. It is how the world has made the daughters of Zion to be a damn mockery. We love to eat. Grandma dies. We're unhealthy. We're sick. And that's just a fact. Can I say this to us? Whatever you put into anything, that's what you will garner. I've been planting the garden all this week, Mama. But I put my heart into it. And I labor. And so I wanted to check on the plants this morning because I know the labor and the intensity that I have put in the garden. I don't do it because it is something to do. I do it because I love Yisrael. I love my Achim. If anything I want to leave in the presence of their eyes is a mature man, a strong and vibrant and true in every endeavor and all causes. I have no biological children to leave nothing to. I have no one that will extend from me. I'm not sad, Mama. I'm not brokenhearted. Believe me, I'm not. But I want to be able among my young men, those that as that Jermaine called last night and how he said, I just love you all, doesn't even know us. I love to hear Arazachin Yarameya, his maturity. We need that. That is the only legacy. I don't care about thousands knowing, just a few. I want them to be strong. You know, it was a time that all, when there were many of those that were here, the young ones, they were growing. It's one thing that they will always say to me, Riak, I want a husband just like you. Although they were young, and little babies, they didn't know what a husband was. I wonder how many have a man today, a true man. They would say it all the time, I want a husband like you. I want my husband to be like you. What is the legacy we're leaving for the young men and for the Bath of Zion to be inspired and rejuvenated by the excellence of his strength and character, that they will want to operate in the beauty of a Bath of Zion? Don't tell me you're beautiful in the inside and you look a horrific mess on the outside. You're not beautiful. That is the composition of one's caring and compassion. That's why Hollywood sucks it out, cut it out, and all. They're not beautiful from the inside. You see women 300 pounds with all this satanic design on their necks and their bodies, on their legs. I said if I was the one that did that, I wouldn't even touch that. I would discriminate. You can't come to my parlor. I would. I said to my Isha yesterday, look at that. No shame. No. Animals don't even look like that. It is sad too. Where does a man find a wife? Tell me. You don't get quiet on me. You can turn me down. It makes no difference. Where does he find a wife? Tell me. There's a physical attraction too. Must be a physical attraction. You know, Im, I said when I went to my natural father's house one time, the only, that I noticed around his place it was very clean and impeccable. Was he that way? Okay. All right then. It was very clean. The outside was very orderly, very clean, everything in place. It was. It's sad. The women of the dark hue has made mockery by every people. The Chinese, the Mexicans. It's amazing. You see these women of the dark hue with all these tattoos, and you don't even see Mexican women with that. You see that. is wicked. Fat hogs, what they are. And women think because they have a large tush that that's... They think that way. This is what your mother should be teaching. But we're so full of damn folly and frivolity, we don't teach them that. I recall one day I was talking to this man. He was a very bright man, intelligent. He says to me, I'm counseling a friend of mine, her daughter. She's about 16, 17. And say that she is one that is just totally rebellious. And so she says to her mother, I don't have to worry about making money because I will make money. And the mother said, you drop out of high school, you will not fulfill the responsibilities. She said, Mama, look at all this back here. I can shake this. This is how deluded. She said, I can dance. This is how cheap the mothers have sold the daughters. This is how cheap the minds of the daughters are. It's sad. I'm going to teach you in a minute. I'm not looking for any kind of applause. I don't want to live that way. I want to be an example to my young men. I want them to see the vibor and the vitality of my strength. I want when we walk together, it is a sound conversation. When I talk to them in the gym, it's sound, not competitive. I know I'm not young and as beautiful as this man, but my age has its own beauty. It has its own charm. He doesn't have gray hair like me, but my gray hair has its own charm and its own beauty. I don't want to be like him. I don't want to have his youth. I want him to experience my youth in the element of my wisdom that I teach him. My beard will never be black and beautiful like his beard. Never! So that's his beauty. That's his strength and his beauty. That's his beauty. And so we all as a nation should have a beauty that stands. And when we go, I'm telling you, it will speak with great volume when people see us. It's a fact. And it's sad. The stupidity among y'all's people. I want to teach from four words today. And I want to begin in one of the most revered books. One of the most scrutinizing books, if I must say, or writings. One that is not comprehended by man. One that doesn't present unto them this gala, this revelation of the power of Yah's Torah. And so you have this speculation about things, and a consistent speculation. I want to ask you a question. Is there any word in the book of Genesis that is less valuable than the book of Revelation? They're all equal. They're all the same. They're all profound, very profound. Because every word that Yah speaks is pure. Every word. And I want to speak from this perch, the wrath of Almighty Yah. Just those words. Why it is implemented, upon who, and the reason. And what we as a nation must do as a people. That we are not given over unto this earth. The wrath of Yah is his resentment. It is not just a resentment, it is a keen resentment. It is not just a resentment, it is a hatred. It is a distaste in his mouth. It is his haron that he despises. And there are things that he hates. And there are things that among his nation they must cease. And if they don't cease, woe unto you, Yisrael. And if we don't find the strong men that stand in the gate and rebuke and judge
and set in order. We have this weakest jellybackish of men. They're so full of wickedness, they will not confront wickedness. They're so full of their own evilness, they will not confront evil. They're so vile and so weak, they will not even confront it. They have no presence of Yah about them. They will not correct matters. And so when a man speaks upright, he is ta'ab, he is despised by many. So it makes no difference whether you love me, whether you care for me, it makes no difference, period. Because this book is truth. And we that are the servants of Yah, we must live by every word. It is pure. I will give us consolation. I would have began here in the book of Revelation. Giliana. Revelation chapter 14. Now, is this important to understand and to know? I'm going to read four particular verses from the book of Giliana. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 9. As you are commanded the three Melechim to open up the profound revelations of his personality. It says in verse 9, and the third Melech followed them, and he decried this with a loud voice. He said, if any man worship the beast, if we give it over unto the nation of Nahash. What is Nahash? When you make mockery of Yah. When there is a construct for you to walk within the parameter of that, you don't do that. Did he not give Adam and Eve a construct, Chava, that you can eat from every tree, but of that tree, don't eat? He gives us instructions about Torah, what we can do and what we cannot do. And any time we go beyond that or defy that, it is the spirit of Nahash. It is the nature of a beast. It is the nature not of a man or woman, but that which is to be destroyed and brought down to the dust of the earth. Any man that received this mind and worshiped the beast and the image, and to receive this conscience that his mind is so seared. His conscience has been marked with the seared iron where one cannot receive truth. There is no delight in truth. There is no love for truth where they cannot even receive the truth. And he has this in his forehead. He has it in his mind and in his yacht. This is what Yah says. Should this be avoided? Because this doesn't make us feel nice, should we omit this? I want you to catch this. It said, the same shall drink, the same one shall drink of the wine of the wrath of Yah. The wrath of Yah. The same shall drink of the af, the resentment, the hatred. He said, the same shall drink. Nahash. But our minds do not absorb truth. He said, the same shall drink from the wrath of Yah. And Yah says it's going to be shafach. It's going to be poured out, Israel. It's going to be poured out without mixtures of the cup of his za'am, of his indignation, of his terrifying anger, of his hostility toward a people. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone, in the presence of the Kodesh Melechim and in the presence of Yahshua HaMashiach. And if we think that there is going to be some kind of sympathy for us, we're wrong, Yisra'el. We're talking about the wrath of Yah, the reason why, the implementation, what procures that among us. And we think in some of our practitions and our ways that it doesn't incur this, you got to find out. He said, the same shall drink from the wrath of Yah. It's a time that we must be sober and beyond the measures of sober. The elderly men and women must be vigilant. They must make an imprint on everyone that they encounter. I don't care who it is, sinner, wicked man, righteous one, our attitude, our personality should make an impact on them. As they watch, they look, they observe. And wonder, they ponder, It should be that way with us. We go into the market, they should wonder, who is that man? Where is he from? Look at that woman. Look at her stride. Look at her beauty, the essence of her beauty. The same shall drink of the wrath of Yah, and that is without sympathy, without mixture. We don't know what that is. We can clown around like jackasses all the day, but payday is coming. I will show us how we clown around like jackasses and what brings the wrath of Yah upon us. We're not a people that's given to Torah because we don't give a damn. You don't love Yah, you don't love you. And if you don't love you, you don't give a damn about anyone. You can clown all you want to, you don't give a damn. I can be of pretense and falsehood with my achim and talk all that talk I want to. It doesn't mean a damn thing unless I'm disciplined by what I teach and my light. And my light shines that they may see that. I don't have anything at all, Yisra'iyah. Nothing. He goes on to tell us in Revelation chapter 15. As Yah began to pour out the plagues upon the nation and nations, he said he sent for seven melachim with the seven last plagues. Revelation 15:1, and I will drop down to Revelation 15:7. It says, and I saw another sign in the Shemaim, great and marvelous. He said, I saw seven melachim, those that have the perfect spiritual revelation of all things. That is what the numerics of seven implies. There's a perfect revelation. There's the wisdom of the matter. He said, having the seven last plagues, for in them is filled up with the wrath of Yah. People get upset because I talk like this. But this is in the book. This is what is written in the book. It is not what I'm implying, it's what the book speaks. Yah says, I sent a perfect command or a perfect government, and out of their mouths shall come the seven last plagues of despair. There will be no tikvah, no hope. And it says that the vials or the bowls that they possess, they're full. The brim is running over with what? The wrath, the haron. The haron is only Yah's anger. I'm glad I don't know it. I'm glad that there are no superlatives to describe it. It is just harun, harun. It is the wrath of Yah. It is explicitly dealing with the nature of Almighty Yahweh. I don't understand what harun is. You may be wise. I don't. I have searched the aura of linguistics. I can't find harun. It only implies that it associate, express the anger, the wrath of Yah. And he says to the Melech, fill it up. What have we done to cause this great king to be so sad that he literally hate our presence? You know, my mother would say to me at times, and all of her children, of course, I understood what she was saying. She would say, oh, I just hate you. You make me hate you. In essence, she was saying, your wickedness is so vile. Maybe I'm the only one that experienced that. But my mother would tell me that. I hate you so much. I hate you. It wasn't that she literally hated me. She hated everything about my character, my personality, my ways. And what that would cause me to do would wait. Because I needed her affection. I wanted her affection. I wanted her to love me. I wanted to sense that what I perceived what love was. But she would say that to me. I hate you. Oh, I hate you so much. And this is what Yah said. I hate you all. I hate you. I see a house. I see a people that nothing will straighten them out. Nothing will cause them to walk erect and right. I see the men, they're full of folly. I see the women, they're so laden with sin, they're silly. And every little thing that one says, leave them away from the discipline of the Torah of Almighty Yah. They allow all kinds of things to creep into their minds. Men are talking about things that have no value when it comes to the kingdom, excellence. And you don't see the Tomi, the perfection of Yah in their walk, in their minds, and in their spirit. The only thing you see is folly and stupidity. I don't want to be that way, Yah. I want to be a strong man, to be an example. I want this young boy here to love me and to see a man. And when I say a word, he understands that. I want this lad. I want them to know when I say something. They know that it's just not verbiage, but it is the example of my Ruach that they can determine that it's right to do. Verse 7. Yah says here, and I heard, and one. Revelation 15:7. He says, and one of the four beasts gave to the seven Melachim seven golden. Nothing can tarnish, pollute. That is what gold. Our faith must be tried that it may come forth as pure gold. So nothing tarnish our faith. Nothing tarnish our walk with Yah. And they had seven bowls of the last plagues of Yah. It says full tome, overflowing full of the wrath of Almighty Yah. And he gives an explicit explanation that one that lives olam viyat, he lives forever. Now do you hear that? Three verses now. The witness full of his wrath. Full of his wrath, full of his wrath, full of his wrath. We're not going to be content or satisfied with money. Money never satisfies the heart. You're not going to be content and satisfied with a house three times this size. How can a woman that doesn't even keep a small, modest house clean, how is she going to keep something clean this large? That's not going to satisfy you. You know that a man has the true nature of Yah, having food and raiment. He is there with content. You know that's the nature of Yah. You know what a woman understands the beauty of having food and raiment and understand the beauty of that. It brings about an excellent beauty about a woman today. I look at these hogs I hear today. They look like damn bulldogs. Don't look at me. That's just a fact. They look like bulldogs. The anguish of their anger, the hostility. Why? Because no man wants them. No man! They don't want them. And the ones that they are taking advantage of, they're whores just in the houses of prostitution. You don't have to buy it. You can get upset all you want to with me. We're dealing with the reality. No man, I wouldn't have it. I'm not going to even look at it. And don't even offend me by looking at me. That's just a fact. We don't give a damn about ourselves. We look just like the world. There must be a difference between my people and the people of the world. We must look different. Our beauty must be more excellent. Our shine must be excellent. Our physical look must be different. And that's a fact. That's a fact. We must have the liveliness, as the midwife says, these Hebrew boys, when they are born, they jump and they squawk and they move. You cannot kill them. We get the true nature of what a Hebrew is within us, a true Yisraelite. The nations shall see our beauty as they saw the beauty of Abraham, as they saw the beauty of Sarah. As the king said, this is a gem of a jewel. As they saw the beauty of Ruth, Juzian. Judith. There must be a beauty about his people. There's a reason why we are so distorted and so disfigured. I'll get to that. I want to read something else, Yisrael. We hate the man that stands in the shachar, that he stands in the gate of our mind. That's what shachar is. He stands in the gate of our minds and our hearts. And he judges the thoughts of our processes, and he shows us what has been processed in our mind. We hate that man. And when he speaks upright and tells us we're wrong, and show us we're wrong according to Torah, then we abhor him. We say that he is wicked. He's doing that. He's not right. He is suffering. That's how we speak of that man. We're quiet, Tom. That's how we speak of that man, because he speaks upright. He speaks Yosha, he speaks straight. And so when one judges us, we don't want to be judged. We don't want to rectify our ways with Yah. Something is wrong in our damn minds. Something is wrong with me if I'm acting like I was when I was 22. If I'm acting like I was when I was 22, I was a man. When I was 22 years old, I sat down among those men. We would sit down, we would have sessions, what we call rap sessions. We would talk about political, we would talk about the environment, we would talk about the socio-economic oppression of the people of the diaspora. We would talk about the oppression of the reign, of the terror of the oppressor of the white man. That is what we talked about. We would talk about those things that were relevant and that would elevate our minds to a deeper degree of comprehending and learning things that were valuable to us. And we read books to learn. I would read all the time. 22, 23, that's the way I talk. I didn't play. Last fellow played with me, I was 21 years old. I was in the military. And I said, Ziggy boy, I tell you this. We call him Trash Can. He was about 6'3", 210 pounds. And I was a little fellow, about 100. I had come out of basic AIT, so my body wasn't, it was clean. I was about 165, 75 pounds, but I was muscular, and I looked that way. You understand? So I said to him, I said, Ziggy, let me tell you this. If you want your play toy, I'm a boy, you write home to your mama and tell her to send your teddy bear, because I don't play. He was ready to take my head off, and he could have, too. I put on the boxer glove with him one day, and he knocked. When he hit me in my jaw, I didn't just go out right then. It was delayed. I crumbled. He said, oh, bro. Why? Because he knew that once I said it straight, he knew that I was a faithful man. When his mama needed money, I say, here's the money, Zig. He said, I pay. I say, you owe me nothing. You're my homeboy. Take the money. Send it home to your mama. I may need something one day. That's the way we operate it. But don't play with me, man. Don't clown with me. I'm not buying that. And so we would sit down with Theodis Tucker, men that went on to be lawyers and detectives, and we would rap. We expressed the sentiments of the last poets, Huey P. Newton, Malcolm X. We talked that way, not some jackassing and clowning. And we were mature. When we would walk in the villages of Stuttgart, Germany, people would watch us and look. And these were secular men. It's just the truth. I'm sitting my son, Don Juan, T.K. Tucker was about 6'8". He was a huge, beautiful man. And me, the little nub of them. We would walk down the street. They were very immaculate dressers. Could dress well. T.K. was a tall man, but he dressed well. His clothing flowed on him. And we would walk down the street, people would hang out their windows and watch and look. We would go places, and that's just the truth. Wicked, corrupt men. Now, if that drew the attention of the people that knew not Yah, then we as a nation, we should draw the praises of nations. Of every nation that we come in contact with. So the ones from Mexico, they come in and say that the ones of the dark hue, they're not worth a damn. The ones from the eastern countries, from China and Japan, they say, look at them, look at them, look at their women, look at the men. We must have some strong warriors. I want to be strong. I'm not talking about lifting 500 pounds. I want my character to be strong. I want my beauty to be strong. I'll represent Yah when I go out. And I want people to know it. Hallelujah. One more verse here in Revelation. Giuliana 16:1. It says in Revelation chapter 16:1, this is the first bowl of the vial poured out. He said, I heard a great voice out of the sukkah, out of the tabernacle, saying to the seven melakim, go your way. Go the derech de Yakaman. He says, and pour out the vials of the wrath of Almighty Yahweh upon thee, O Lamb. Does it say that? I want you to go. Now, four verses here that people want to deal with the prototypes of Gilyana, and yet something that simple. Men want to show that they have a great excellence of knowledge about things. I look at the simplicity of things, Yisrael. When I saw that the other day, I was sitting, Yah, what do I say this Shabbat? Just only the wrath of Almighty Yah, his Haron. Is that important as that Yah loves you? Sure it is. This should make you feel the same way as you hear a message that tingleizes your sensation that is acceptable. He's talking about his wrath. He's talking about his haron. And nobody understands that unless we understand the very nature of what happened in the first world when he destroyed everything. We're talking about the haron of Yah. We talk about a resentment that is so resenting, is so keen that he gave a people his son. And we're still full of our damn sins and our folly and our damn wickedness. We're serving a damn God that doesn't give a damn about us. We suffer the damn vanity and lust of our bellies. That should not and ought not to be. He said, I've given you everything. You haven't given me one damn thing. And we think we're getting by. The wrath. He said, the fullness. Yisrael, he's not holding back anything. Your brothers, your sisters, your sons, and your daughters are going to betray you. They already do that. They already do that. They betray the wisdom of mom and daddy. Your sons and daughters already do that. They betray that. They betray the experience of life that father, mother had, grandmother. Young women talk to grandmothers and great grandmothers as though that they're wiser than them. Oh, I know. You don't know a damn thing. If you did, you would not be in the shape you're in. Young man having despair as to what his father says to him. Something is twisted. Why would Yah do that? We think in order to procure that, we got to do something that is just beyond the scope of comprehension. I want to show you something here in the book. Turn quickly. I want to read this from Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, verse 5, two verses here. Look at what the messenger, the deputy of Yah says, Shaul. He uses the word mortify. When you mortify something, you put it to death. He said, destroy, put to death, eliminate that aggressive nature of your folly and your sin. Colossians 3, 5, mortify therefore your bodily or the members of your body. Your thought, your tongue, your mind, your heart. He said, you got to put it to death. You must destroy that. Destroy the members which are upon the earth. He tells us these things. He says, fornication or zana, this uncleanliness. He tells us inordinate affection. And he uses the word evil, concupiscence, or evil desires. To desire things that you know Torah say don't desire. To want to be a part of something that Torah commands you not to be a part of it. To act in a way that Torah restricts us from that area. Evil desires, he says, and those that are so damn greedy, they are covetous, they're full of lust, they want, they can never have enough. He said, which is idolatry. Now these four things, five things, this is just a list of them. I will deal with the rest. He said, because of these, the wrath of Yah comes upon the children of Sa'ah, of disobedience, those that are rebellious, those that defy Yah. What our minds and the strength of our will is vanity. What our conversation is all about evil concupiscence, evil thoughts, evil things, our conversation, it is not on the things of Yah. He says, for this reason comes the wrath of Yah. For your spirit that loves to placate with the gods, the god of your damn belly. That's what this world is. And every god you will see, unless it is Hercules and these gods, Buddha, look at these beasts. They're all beasts. We are out of control, Yisrael. We are out of control with our conversations, with our mind, with our eating habits. We are out of control. We are out of control, Yisrael. We are out of control. We might as well get real and realize that I'm out of control. And the reason we can't control a damn thing, we're not willing to exercise ourselves in the Torah. And that's the fact. We're out of control. We're out of control. You let someone correct you and tell you you're silly, or someone tell you you're overweight or you're fat, and see how angry you get. See how mad you get. And so you'd rather be with those that will not confront you. It's a damn dismal shame we as Yisrael are the way we look. We are beautiful people. I'm not going to stop saying that. And whatever you put into it, that's what you're going to get back. If you put nothing into it, you're not going to get anything back. If you put nothing into nothing from nothing leaves nothing. And that's just a fact. Now, I don't care if you get upset, whether you're male or female, it makes me no difference. It is time that we move beyond the paradox that we are. It is time out for making excuses. It is time for us to grab hold to what is right. We are people that we have lost the fear of Yah before our eyes. And we know the fear of Yah is the root of wisdom. Yeah. Yeah. I labor hard in the garden because I'm looking. I promised this EMAVC, I promised her plenty for my friend here, Brussels sprouts. And so I want the Brussels sprouts to grow. I was saying to my Zochim, but I mean, how do we water this? He said, well, we can go this way or that way. I said, well, let's look at this way. That's an excellent way. How do we fertilize this? I didn't labor there in vain. I labored for fruit. And we are not bearing fruit because we are not laboring in the vineyard. We're laboring in the damn folly yard. And we can see the folly because our disposition is just like this fat damn greedy world. We look like the world. The only thing that caused me to fear is these babies. I just pray that, yeah, if I'm around, I'm around. If I'm not, I have no fear of dying. I don't. I know that things are becoming progressively worse. Parenting, it is of no value. Mothers really don't give a damn. They got time for all kind of folly. In my days, the mothers trained the children how to sit, how to be disciplined. We got damn time for YouTube and MySpace and all of that, but no time for my bath, my son. My children. Something is wrong there. We got time to soothe all of our vanity and our folly. But when it comes to the reality of the realist, we have no time. We got time to act like jackasses, but to set the house in order, you can't even hardly know different than the hood rat of a woman, they call them, in the ghettos. The homes are disorderly. It's unclean. There's no order to the home. Something is wrong. You go to the hood rat, you find women, what they say. I don't stereotype all the women in those positions because there are young women there that are striving. They're striving to come up out of the cauldron. They've been abused. They've been taken advantage of. They've been nothing but sex machines. And then there's a sickness. And they're sick of that. They're young men the same way. But you go to the hood, you see the same thing among the nation of Yah. I don't care if they all live together, they're associated. You see men that are lazy as hell. You see women that are just, all they do is eat and gromadize and gorge themselves. And that's all they want to talk about, folly and foolishness. These things come the wrath of Yah. And that shouldn't be. The daughters of Tizion should have a beauty that when you go out into the marketplace that everyone looks. I'm not saying you be a size 4. There are women that are 200 pounds and look excellent. I saw these women yesterday. It was a shame. I saw a man. I said to my issue, I guarantee he weighs at least 400 plus pounds. We must represent the healing of a nation. If I die, I will die laboring and trying. That's a fact. I will die trying. I'm not going to sit on any leaves. If I die, I will die working and laboring. We're so sensitive to our emotions. That's why Shaul said you need to mortify, kill off the members of your flesh, the things that you remember that draw you into your anger and your hostility, your wickedness, your accusations. He said, kill it off, kill it off, kill it off and destroy it. Mortify. Because these actions, they are steeped in idolatry. Your evil concupiscence, your evil passion, your evil desire, your evil conversation, it is steeped in idolatry. And for this reason comes the wrath of Yah. Your conversation whereby the Torah is not the mainstay focus of everything you do. And that should be the mainstay focus of everything we do. When I'm working, that's my focus. When I'm laboring, I work as unto Yah. Yah has always given me favor. He has always given me favor with men. Even in my ignorance, he gave me favor. When I labor, I will always say, even in my ignorance, this is unto the Most High. I want him to be pleased at the end of the day. I did not sloth. I did not try to take advantage. I will not use my achim and cause them. I want to work harder than them to show them my love. It is based upon principle. I want to work harder than him. And could I ask him Thursday to help me? He would have came in a heartbeat. I know he has his babies. And he works for me every day. As he works for us. As he works for you to hear this. And for equipment that he gives offerings so that you can hear it. I know my Achim come in late. Just give me a hand to 12. And go with your families. I'm not a damn callous beast. I'd rather do his part and his part and his part. You'll get something to eat. I'll be here. You take care of you. I'll be all right. This is a wicked generation. I hate it. I'm not going to miss this damn world. And that's a fact. I don't want to go to Paris or London. I want to go into the kingdom. The only thing that, and I won't have the ability to miss, if I go before she does. If I have my right, I don't want to leave her. I'd rather she go and then take me the next hour. Or right after her, and you bury us both. Put us in one box, drop us in the ground. That's the only thing. But it doesn't work out that way. For these things come the wrath of Yah. So we don't think that we're not mortifying the deeds of our flesh. Can I define that in a little more excellent way? Well, let's go to Ephesians. In the book of Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3. This is Yah speaking to us. Again, he used the words fornication. And he did not say just some, but he said all uncleanliness. Ephesians 5:3. He said all uncleanliness. Not some. All uncleanliness. All uncleanliness or covetousness. He said, let it not be once named among you as becoming Kedoshim of Yisrael. Activities and actions that you did in the world, don't let it be named among you as the seed of Yisrael. Your lust, your desires, your covetousness, it should not be named. He says, neither filthiness, nidah, not your bloody sinful mind and your bloody sinful hand. He says, nor foolish talking. We don't talk foolish, do we? You don't get together and laugh like a backpacker, jackals or hyena like jackasses. We don't do that. That's not a part of my forte. It just never has been. That's what the Torah says. No foolish talking. Talking that is empty. Talking that is evil. Talking that is not sustained by Torah. Talk that's full of laughter and folly and clownishness. He said, no foolish talking. No foolish talking. No foolish talking. No foolish talking. Not only the foolish talking. He said, but no gesturing. Your lies are flattery. You look good, girl. Boy, you look so nice. That's a lie. She doesn't look nice. She's not doing well. He is not doing well. Nor your damn flattery of jesting. When a man or a woman flatters you, they hate you. I don't give a damn who it is. It's almost like a mama daughter, 300 pounds, a son, 400 pounds, lazy dog. You a good boy. That's a lie, mama. He's not a good boy. He's a damn pig. She doesn't look well, mama. That's flattery. You hate your daughter. You laugh till you will tell her the truth. You a damn lie, daddy. You don't give a damn about your son. You laugh till you will tell him the truth. You got us all covered. You're damn jestering. Your lies are flattery. Oh, she's a sweet girl. She's not sweet. She's not doing so well. No, she's a hoe. And everybody knows she's a hoe, but you're that dumb and stupid. Yah tells us we're a whore. He tells us we're a backslidden heifer. We love this damn foolish talk. I worry, don't worry. We think, oh, I'm not doing what she's doing. Oh, I'm doing what he's doing. You're doing worse than what they're doing. And you think it's all right. It's not all right. It grieves the heart of Yah. He says, I'm going to pour it out. And damn it, nobody's going to stop me. He said, fill it up. Fill it up. The babies are going to cry. Mom, if you even love the babies. Dad, if you even care for Yisrael. If you love your grandbaby like you love that baby. There's no place in the Torah. But David tells you, Yah tells you to love your mama more than anyone else. No place in the book. And every mother's an Ima of Yisrael. And we think because of our gesturing and our damn foolishness, our laughter, our continuous, I don't even want my, my woman even knows that she knows better, even at the table. I'll look at it. Don't go that way with me. Don't even play that way with me. Don't even go that way. Don't even try it. Don't even. I don't want you sitting at the table with me and you laugh that Simeon hears your laugh. And I mean that. Hell, it's not that funny. I didn't think she needs to be crying. It's not that damn funny. And I said, you know that things that irks me. And that's one. I don't like it, woman. You got me when you go in that window. I don't like it. Don't. I don't laugh with the little children. Our fourth parents didn't laugh with children. Even when a daughter got a certain age, she still honored the strength of her mother. When a man, a young man, came between the elders, he shut his damn mouth and he was quiet. He didn't talk. He listened and he observed. I will, my friend, Toda. We think we're getting by, Yah. We continue to pollute ourselves. We don't want to kill off our foolish ways. Why am I saying this? Because every part of this book is important. Those four words, the wrath of Yah. He says, stop your foolish talking. There should not be no gesturing among you, no flattering. Don't lie to her. Don't lie to him. Don't tell him, man, you sure look nice today. You don't look nice. He's got a beautiful, he doesn't have a beautiful spirit on him. She is so sweet. She's not sweet. She's kind. She's not kind. He is not nice. She is not a beautiful bath. He is not an ox that is charming. You don't speak damn lies like that. That's gesturing. It's flattery of lies. He said, which none of these are necessary. You don't have to do it. You have no fire in your life. He said, but rather what you do, you get together, you don't give hoodoo unto Yah, you don't give toda unto Yah. That should be the gathering and the consensus of all Yisrael. Toda Yah, you drive out the evil demonic powers, the shadims of darkness. You don't do that, we don't do that. You don't go to the garden like those of our forefathers in the cotton field, and they were singing, kumbaya, oh, kumbaya. Yeah, and cause them to rise with strength and a nurturing that they didn't even know they had. We clown with gesturing and foolish talk that doesn't profit. I would be a damn wicked man to talk to my son and talk foolish that I don't see the maturation of his life. I'll be a wicked man to talk to this man that struggles with his challenges that he maintained the course. I would be a damn wicked man. We said we talk folly and clown like jackasses. That he lose the nature of the streets of Yorkshire, the power of the Ruach has no discipline to guide him and to maintain him and to keep it until Yah prevails for him. Yeah. That's what the door of folly and evil talk opens up. Yes. And teach the young women how to be beautiful wives, yes. How to be chaste, how to be clean. Keep the damn houses clean and keep the babies clean. These damn wicked women that call themselves mother, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to us. You don't teach a damn thing. These silly damn men want to be cooler. Well, you're not cool, man. Think that you got flair. You have no flair. Think you got something. You don't have a damn thing. More flesh is as grass. Think you holding something, you're holding nothing but a pile of flabby damn bones. We taught the daughters to be Jezebels and the young men to be effeminate, unclean young men. That's why they don't respect them. I go somewhere with my wife, I wanted to represent the kingdom beauty. We're full of foolish talk and gesturing. Is that all right, Yah? Ari what the Ruach HaKodesh caused Shaul to write to me. He says in the latter part of verse 4, we need to give Torah. For this you know, in verse 5, for this you yada, know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, have an inheritance in the kingdom of Messiah and of Yah. He says this now. Let no man deceive you with vain, empty words. We love empty words. We love conversations that never, I want to be fruitful. I want a beauty to shine and an excellent from me. I do. He said this, I want you to know and to understand. Let no man deceive you with vain words, with empty words, with foolish conversation, with gesturing of flattering. He says, for because of these things, I just read those things, your foolish talk and gesturing. See, a pure mother would be ashamed to be a clown and a jackass. A true man of Yah, he doesn't love the folly and the frivolity. For these things, for your foolish gesturing, for your damn clownishness. When you clown like that, you're insecure. When you clown like that, you have no security. You have doubt. You're not sure of yourself. I'm sure of me. Of all things, I'm sure of me. I know who I am. I'm sure. So I do not have to present this false, delusional, what we think is jovial. It's not jovial for these things. For these things, for foolish talking, for gesturing, for these things. Don't let the vain words to deceive you. For because of these things come the wrath of Yah. We think it's because we are bound down, as some believe that these lions were idols, bound down to that. You're in the same condition if you bow down to that as you are with jesting and foolish talk. They're all the same. For these things, because of these things, because of your folly, because of your vain words, when something is empty, it doesn't produce anything. When a shroff is empty, it has no direct alliance with Yah's mind. And because of your vain conversation, if you go out, he has a young man that's writing me. He seems like a beautiful brother. He's into the law enforcement there in Mississippi. He says, Ray, I'm kind of afraid. You know, I'm afraid of you. I'll write him back. I hope he's listening today. I said, you don't have to be afraid of me, my friend. Come on. So he was telling me how he was making his compost. He used the manure. I wanted to write him and say, my friend, you can't start seeds that way. So I said, call me. He says, Ray, I am on call 24/7. I would not want his job. But the letter, the ox seems so beautiful. So beautiful. Just like that brother last night, Jermaine. Beautiful spirit in the man. Quiet. I like that. I know you're listening, come on. He'll put you to work now. And he'll show you what you have. I said to the Achim the other day, I said, I'll make sure that I'll just talk to you all. You know? I said to them, we were working, I said, do I work you? I don't want to work you harder than the... I don't want to work you harder. Am I working you harder than the... I said to them, I'm working you harder than that. And so my big show, he said, well, you're all right, Riak. Wasn't long I said, big man, step it up. Now you got to step it up, man. Step it up. Because I'm stepping it up. Put it up, big man. He stepped it up too. So maybe he rethought when I asked him, do I work you harder than you? All that saw my lips, you got it all right. For these things, that's why we got to kill ourselves. It's not anyone that's troubling you but you. Your wickedness trouble you. Your vile, unkind ways, they trouble you. It's not someone else, it's you. It was Yisrael's sin that troubled them. It wasn't Yah. It wasn't the prophet. It was their wickedness that they had hid. Now he gives us a list of things. He says, let no man deceive you in verse 6 with vain words. For because of these things come the wrath of Yah upon the children of Sarah of disobedience. See, that's why the wrath comes. Pour out my wrath. I will give us some examples, Yisrael. He said, kill them all, damn it. He's going to kill your babies. He's going to kill your mama, daddy. He made us. You can't explain this to scientific mythology, this creation. And you can act like a jackass all you want. You can continue in your gesturing. You can continue your foolish talking. Your laughter that rises above the heavens and the crackling. I showed to my Israel the other day, I say, your laughter is like this, just like the rustling or the sound of thorns and needles under a pot. So is the laughter of the foolish. I say, that's why, woman, I draw from the book. I don't draw from some damn emotions. Don't challenge what I say. Not that she challenges. I said, I want to show you something what the book says, all right? And there's nothing more irritating than putting some sand on the pot and putting some thorns in and moving that around. Who likes that sound? I don't like it. And there's nothing more vile than that. That's why the elders should always, their lives, even if they're not talking Torah, it's the beauty of their quietness. I say to my friend all the time, don't talk to me when I'm working. I can talk all day and work. But I want to make sure as I put up, Yah, bless this plant. Bless it. I pray over all of them. Yah, give it increase. Please, Yah. Let it be fruitful. I don't get weary in what I do. It's not tiresome to me because I love what I do, because it causes my opponent to sweat. It cleanses my body. It causes me to feel strong and to feel healthy. It causes me to have flexibility where I can bend and bend down and move. I'm not going to change that. And I'm up there in that sun and the vitamin E and all the nutrients my body needs. And even the very resistance of my nature, it is subdued by the power of that Shemesh, of the sun. And that's a fact. Do you get weak? Sure, I get weak. But I can press beyond that weakness. We got to press beyond the weakness of our flesh. We cannot, Yisrael. If you love Yisrael, you are not foolish just with the Ach. You will not clown with them. You will not tell little things to create some kind of humorous environment. You don't look to say things that cause this eruption of laughter and folly and lies to be spoken. Anything you do should mortify, destroy. When the young daughter sees the mother, she should examine herself. When the mother sees the young daughter, she should examine herself. When the young man sees the elder and vice versa, they should examine themselves. I don't want a mantra that he thinks he's cool and he's on money. I don't want to be on money. I want to walk in truth. I don't want to be on money. I don't want to be filly fly. I want to be virtuous. Chayil. I want to be strong in Torah. I want to have the tefillah just like David. He was ruddy, but he was a beautiful young one. I want to have that kind of beauty. I want to have that kind of charm. I want to have a love of Torah in my heart. I want my words to be seasoned well, because I know that we're going to be judged by every idle word. Every word you speak, mama, every word, daughter, every word, daddy, every word, son, you're going to be judged. I will show something whereby, yeah, he's going to live our iniquity, and he's going to cause that. We think we're getting by, but we're not getting by. We get weak. I don't give a damn under the cloak of darkness. That's why sin loves to be under the cloak of darkness. We have a little daytime, and the night season come where we can't work. You're not going to get it right. You're going to get gloomy and darkness. The anguish is going to overtake your death, and all kinds of things going to overtake your damn mind. You're not going to be able to get to Yah. You're not going to be able to cry out to Yah. So he gives us a little night, a day season, a little reprieve whereby we can cry Torah instead of your damn folly and your damn stupidity of justing. You cry Torah and teach the bath how to cry Torah unto Yah. I don't take one word back. We that are supposed to be Sadiq scarcely make it. Barely make it. We're not even on the threshold. And it's a sad shame. It's, you know, my Akshim, as I see these women, you know, the mothers really didn't take time. What I think about my own natural sister, I would tell my mother all the time, hell, I wouldn't say that like that. You didn't teach her how to be a woman. You didn't teach her how to honor her body. What do you expect, mama? You didn't teach her anything. That would shut my mother's mouth because she would deride her. I felt sorry for the woman because I know she's pitiful. She called me 2 weeks ago. I haven't called her back. Yeah, I don't hide nothing. I said, you didn't teach her how to be a woman. I'm talking about a 24, 25-year-old man talking like that to his mother. You didn't teach her the beauty of a mother. You didn't teach her how to be chaste. You did not teach her how to honor her body. You didn't teach her that. And you talk to her that way. You call her that. What are you? You got 6 babies by 6 different men. She hasn't reached that plateau. If she's all that, mama, all I want you to tell me, what are you? It will shut her mouth. It will shut her mouth every time. That didn't make my natural sister right. It didn't make her ways right, but my mother didn't teach her how to be a beautiful woman. My mother didn't teach her how to govern herself. How to govern. My mother didn't teach her that. I was there in the house, she didn't teach her that. And so the only thing could teach my sister were the folly and the frivolity of the world. The only thing that helped me that I would watch men, although they were wicked, I saw the beauty and the strength of a man. I would see those men that I thought were very inspirational. And then I would take their attributes, I would incorporate that into my platform. I would try walking like them. I would try talking like them. There were no mighty men in my life, no strong men. And I was always an observer of men and seeing those things that were of great value that I could incorporate in my life. It made no difference who the man was. I didn't have that. And these are the things that bring the wrath of Yah. And as a young boy, even in those women that are in the Baptist, in the whorehouses, I have never as a young kid seen the men gather. And there's just this consortium, this concentra of folly and frivolity. I've never seen that as a young boy. I've never seen the elderly women when they would sit in their bonnet hats and their long dresses and they would gather at one's house and Granny would say, sit down in that corner. And when they would offer you a piece of peppermint, you had to look at Granny to make sure you could take it. And I've never seen those women act like jackasses and clowns. And the young girls would sit there and we didn't interact and play with each other. And they would watch how those women carry themselves. And they will carry that on, Yisrael. What has happened among the nation of Yah's people? The older men will walk, have a little change in their pocket, and they will be sharp in their ways, Yisrael. We had a pattern to emulate. And there was not this bickering and arguing and fighting. There was one that had a little more knowledge than the rest, and everybody else would be quiet and listen to him. Mama, can I say this? I remember the first time I saw R.J. Nichols. I went to Bill Howell's funeral. I was about 25 years old. I went to that funeral. And the only reason I went was Elizabeth Goldman. You remember? She thought I was her grandson. She loved me like an aunt would love her nephew. She really did. When I go to her house, she would give me coffee. One food she would cook for me, she would cook meatballs with the gravy over rice, and I love that. It's for some reason it would smell so delicious in her home. And I would go and work for her on Saturday, and I would think maybe I'll make $5. She would give me $12 or $15 washing windows. Her and her husband. Her husband's name was Amos. And I would go to their home. But I appreciated everything she would do for me. And so as I was married, older young man, I went to the funeral, and I'll never forget sitting in the car with her and Amos. One of the sisters, she was a tall woman. She came and she bent over. She says, "Who be you, boy?" And I knew because my mother had told me that who my natural father was. And Miss Elizabeth said, "That's Bill Howard's boy." She said, "Boy, who be you? Who be your daddy, boy?" "Oh, that's Bill's boy." Elizabeth, she was getting mad. Because she knew that I was her. And I had no problem with that because she was kind to me. She was. That woman looks down again. She was a dark-skinned woman. She said, "Boy, who be your daddy?" And then Miss Goldman, she was really irate. And I remember watching the men, and one pointed, "That's R.J. Nichols right there." So I was about far from here to my house from them. So as a young man, I just observed. I didn't go over there and integrate in their conversation because there were men that he knew. And I saw this other man kind of somewhat towering over them, the other men sitting, and everybody was quiet. I watched, I said, "This. He's got control of the whole conversation. And ain't nobody talking. Gets mad, he look at him." And I just watched for about 50, the whole time I was there. Not any of the other men challenged him. Said, "Well, hold up, man. He was the one just talking. And he was the one that did all the talking." And they had enough honor for the man that they listened to him. They received, undoubtedly. As the young boy, I was impressed. I said, oh, that's him. Couldn't make out his face. I could make out the symmetry of the physical form of his body. I said, okay. All I was saying, Miss Aunt Elizabeth, that's what I call her. Get me out of here, please. When I got home, I said to my Ishaw, you can't. I'm so happy to be away. And it was some years later after she passed, both of them, I was down there again and the same aunts. Then I said, my mother tells me that that's my father, R.J. Nichols. She said, boy, you're Nichols. I know that. He knew Bill Howard, boy. Because he was a little short man. Not that stubby. She said, you be Nichols, boy. And that was the last time I was among that clan of people. Last time. Period. We can't have this foolishness, Yisrael. That's what brings down a house. Let me move on. I want to get to this quickly. It brings down. Let no man deceive you, what Shaul says, with vain words, for because of these things come the wrath of Yah upon the children of Sarah, because of the children of unrighteousness or that are rebellious. That's why the wrath of Yah come. Because we're rebellious. Because we're not doing what he commands us. We must be teachers and instructors of Yah's Torah, Yisrael. We don't believe what Yah says. Yahshua says, if you love me, did he say that? Then do what I command you. And if we don't do what he commands us, then we don't love him, do we? Can I point that out and give us a reference to understand what I'm trying to show us in the book of Yahkahana, John chapter 3, verse 36. John 3, even as the Emmaus spoke with great strength, he says, he that believes on the Son has everlasting life. John 3, 36. If we believe on the Son, Baltat. Believing on the Son doesn't mean that I believe that I'm all right. That doesn't mean what it means. The word Baltak is having a great confidence with great assurance that one trusts in that. If we trust in Yahshua, what he commands us, is all this what I'm reading from right now, Renewed Covenant? Is this not Brit Hadassah? Then we must do what these things command us in the Brit Hadassah. And so if we believe on the Son, we have everlasting life. And he that believe not the Son shall not see life. If we love Yahshua, then we will do what he commands us. If you love me, then do what I say, is what he said. He says, but the wrath of Yah abides on him. And so there are us that we have the wrath of Yah abiding on us. Because we don't believe, we don't trust Yah. We don't love Yahshua HaMashiach. It is the Ruach that constrains us constantly. It is the Ruach that will not lead us into these activities that we know that will induce and bring the wrath of Yah. We have not the Ruach of Yah. We don't have the Spirit of Yah. Because we have the Ruach, it will not guide and lead us into these things that will bring death and destruction upon us. For these things come the wrath of Yah. Our words are guarded carefully and they're measured. We just don't talk. Our words are precise. We know that in the power of our tongue is life and death. I'm an older man and I'm full of folly with my young men. I bring death upon their lives. I don't want to do that. I don't want to cause them to have a hatred for Yah. I want everything I say cause them to love Yah. I don't care whether we're lifting weights. In that Yah is incorporated. Now we're not like the damned Christians in that dancing for their Jesus. We're not dancing for Jesus. We're in there because we want to be healthy and strong. We want our bodies to have vitality. I want to be strong as I get older. I want to be able to work. I want my physicality to have a strength to it. 99% of our conversations about Yah and the things that must be corrected. That's what our conversations are about. It's not about jokes and laughter and clowning. It's not that way because I don't go that way. Do you ever laugh? Yeah, I will laugh with them every now and then. Hey, I may bump Shimri or Yosipia. Come on, man. One of the But we don't clown. I may do just like I did in here. I say, you know, Yosipia, Yawasadaka, Shimri, you know, I'm just talking to you all. I don't want this to get out. And of course, he's right there listening. And he hear what I'm saying. Hey, man, how you doing? You going to pull the Zake Mahalaya on us? 15 minutes. And see, that would draw an esprit from them. I said, oh, he's in here, huh? Oh, I saw you coming in, but I didn't want you to hear that, all right? But you heard it now. That's not clowning. I don't want to tarnish my reputation among them. I wouldn't do it. I don't want to tarnish it among the bad. I don't care what you think of me. I don't care how you feel about me. I don't care about that. I really don't. I've done nothing against you or to you. Nothing. I tell you the truth. Yahshua said, you hate me now because I tell you the truth? I haven't done anything against you. I deal with your wickedness. You don't like the fact. Just like the one that is in the Shachar, the gate, the one that rebukes you, hate him. You hate him. And that's what I deal with our sins. I deal with our sins. I deal with our aggressive nature against Torah. And that's the way it should be. When I was in Delaware, the old man, I said, old man, don't dress like that. Don't come out here like this around my wife. And I'm at his house. I would never do a man like that. I would never have someone or this his issue in my house or any of y'all. And here I'm walking through the house with a pair of shorts on. I got on a little tank top. No, I would not do that. I would not do anyone like that. I would never do someone like that. I would not do that. I would not do another. I would disrespect. I would dishonor another man that way. And I said, oh, man, hold up. No. You can't do that with me here now. Here, button your shirt up, old man, with your old nappy, hairy chest. Button it up. Yeah, I grabbed his shirt and I buttoned it up for him. I will never do that. I saw that big hog. I said, man, you don't do that. You don't dress like that around here. I will never do that. I will never do that. I will never put a man's wife, even a wicked man, I will never do his wife like that. I will never do a woman like that. I will not even do that. I will not. And I don't want you, woman, trying to impress me. Miss Obama messed these damn women up. Your damn flabby fat arms cover them. Put something down to your elbow. You pick up your arm, damn, it look like water dripping down. It's nasty. That doesn't look well. No man is so armed, there's nothing but look like butter so fat. You don't have no muscles, man. Silly men. I don't care if you don't like it. It's still the truth. I'm appalled at what I see out here. Handsome man like that, wife, where does he find something? You women out there, you can think what you want to. You may think you're fine. You can stretch on your girdle and tighten it all in. But you got to loosen that up with a husband. And what you need to do is learn how to get your damn mouth under control. And beautify yourself and make yourself a beautiful woman. I don't give a damn how old you are. And same thing with you, man. Get around some men, they will teach you. You get around some women, they will teach you. Teach you how to be beautiful. When a woman is not beautiful, she can't teach you how to be beautiful. She raised hell with her husband and mean to him. She can't teach you the beauty of a wife. I'm speaking to Yisrael today. I'm not worried about the world. This is among the filth among his nation. And it's rampant. This is in the homes of the people say they love Yah and they keep Torah. And it ought not to be. It ought not to be. This is why Yah's wrath come. He says, for this reason the wrath of Yah come against you. Romans 1:18. This is who the wrath of Yah is reserved for. Romans 1:18, Romeya, the wrath of Yah is revealed from the Shemayim, from the heavens, against not some. Is gesturing, is that wicked? Against all wickedness. That's what the wrath of Yah is revealed against. You know it's right to do right by your ach. You don't do it right, that's wickedness. You know it's right, we have opportunity to be kind unto each other, you be kind. Much as we have opportunity, let us do tov unto all men, especially the house of Yisrael, that has been so maligned, so mistreated by all nations, sold into slavery and every kind of bondage. Man knows to do it right. You know what it's right to do according to the Torah, and you don't do it, it's sin. You cannot bear the burdens of your acha, your hold. Something is wrong in your mind. When you are a shiftless, wicked thing, it's revealed, the wrath of Yah is revealed from the heavens against all, against not some, but against all wickedness, against all Rishah, against all Rishah, against all the principles not are based upon the principles of Torah. His wrath is coming against that. You know it's right to do it and you don't do it. You know it's right to be kindly affectionate to your acha, your host, and you're not that way. Let your little damn juvenile ways get in your way. Your falling, your gesturing has polluted you. You're not going into the kingdom. And that's a fact. You play all you want to. Akshimri used to quote from Ecclesiastes all the time. Be not given too much foolishness. Ever stupidity and folly. And why die ye before your time? I don't like foolishness. I want to live. He that will love life and see better days, let him refrain his lips from evil, and let there be no guile found in him. The bitterness of your vow when you talk, even the saliva formed in the corner of your mouth. You know that's a stinking spirit. And that's just the truth. We are an example to the nations of the earth. And see these people today, the women silly out there and foolish. The life is just. And then when they see a man that they think is regal, they all of a sudden they get quiet. That's the truth. And I walk past the fools. I wouldn't even waste my time looking at you. That's what they are. You all can placate yourselves all you want to. It's just a fact. And then that sure enough make me walk dignified when I see that. Don't look at me. Tell you, now yesterday I saw these two women. I get out of the car. They look like two cows. One dressed like a man. Her stomach was literally like that and it fold back. And I got out of the car and I just looked at them. And all of a sudden they both just turned. You get sister quietness and they just look. So when I get into the post office to mail, they all inside of the post office. I went, you don't even make me cogitate. That's not a beauty of a woman. Their bodies didn't even look clean. Their feet didn't even look clean. I think there's a proper way a woman, her feet should be. Oh, dirty feet, dirt under the toenails. Come on, I'm a man. I despise that. I don't even like dirt under my nails. I keep them clipped. And I have a brush and I brush them clean all the time. Dirty feet. That's not attractive. Women with feet so callous and hard. No pampering of oneself. Come on. I don't give a damn if you don't love me. I don't care, daughters. Find you someone like T.D. Jakes. He'll tell you you're loose. T.D. Jakes telling you you're loose, but you're actually bound. There's only one beauty that a woman, that Yah created her to bring forth her excellence. And he created that in all women, that she become a jewel of beauty. She prepare herself above all things to be a wife. To be a beautiful wife. And mother teach her the beauty and the etiquette of a woman to be a beautiful wife. Her price is far above rubies. That's what every daughter should be taught, how to be chayim, to be strong, to be beautiful, to be regal. That men will respect their appearance and honor them and love their beauty and will know that it is a choice diadem, a crown of his strength, and the approval of Yah unto him. We teach them how to be nutty as hell, how to be selfish, how to be mean as hell, and how to be wicked. We teach them that. And the avot should teach the young man to be strong by overcoming the enemy. He called the young men because they're strong, because they have overcome the devil, their lust, their wicked ways. That's my responsibility. That's my calling as a man above all things. To teach him how to love his wife and to be affectionate to her and to be kind. And when a man, as I read recently, that when a man has a wife that is kind and honest and decent, he is like no other man. There's no other man like him. Men can compare themselves all they want to. It's almost like a man getting up in the morning, he looks at the beauty of his wife's face. She doesn't see him doing it. He looks at the curvature of her lips, her eyes. He smells the fragrance of her beauty. He looks at her and he quietly gets up. He goes on the way. That's what a man delights in. I do. Just smelling the beauty. Oh, when she slept, but she still smells wonderful. I got a light bulb in my bedroom I've had, Mama, for ever since we've been here. A red light. And I like the way that the reflection. See, I go to bed sometime late, but I see things. The fragrance of her breath, her lips, the lines of her lips. It's not about something that is sensual. It's just a beauty that is expressed beyond the realm of certain things. I will, my friend, bless him with a beautiful wife, yeah, a wife who can find a virtuous wife for a price that's far above rubies. As the young man must be taught how to love a wife, the woman, she must be taught how to honor a man. That's what the Torah commands you. Wife, honor, chamu, honor your husband. To honor him, to hear his words, not to be combative. And husband, to love your wife. Subject yourself unto each other, and then wives submit as the final arbiter. I wouldn't have a wife that's going to be disrespectful to me, because I'm not disrespectful to her. I would tell her, go to hell, woman. Go on. Or I will go. I will not. I'm not going to have a woman disrespectful to me and think she can say anything to me. That's not a woman. That's not a woman. That's a damn beast. That's not a woman. Because a woman has the head, she understands the beauty of authority. Yah the head of Yahshua, Yahshua the head of man, man is the head of woman. She understands that beauty. She's not threatened by that position. And yet you can treat strangers well. I would say to my Isha, you are not with me. You can go out and smile with someone. You can't smile with me. Oh, you're not. It's not going to take you an hour to do that. I'm talking about now. Smile. This is how corrupt the folly and the gesturing has made us. This is what it has done to us. I wouldn't have a woman like that. Not me. I'm not going to have one like that. The value of the daughter is of great value. And you that understand jewels or gems, you will polish that. Make sure the diamond is beautiful and polished. Hallelujah. Got to get it right with Yah. There is no other way. Romans 1:18, for the wrath of Yah is revealed from the heavens against all wickedness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Those that will not tell you the truth and teach you Torah, they hold the truth in unrighteousness. They will not tell you the truth. They will rather promote a lie of folly than promote truth. The wrath of Yah is revealed from the heavens against them. They rather promote gesturing and folly and evil talk. They rather promote their own anger and their hostility and their own corruption instead of the truth. You can never transform anyone without truth. You can never change a young man without telling him the truth. You can never change a woman without telling her the truth or teach her the methods of truth. You must tell them the truth. Even the best of friends will say, man, you're a mess. What you did was wrong. No, you were wrong, man. You were not right. Mother, I remember when I was in Germany, T.K. Tucker. I don't know and didn't know. I'm learning love every day. I didn't know how to love, but I was about to do something. He towers over me around 6'8". Hands like that. And because of my friendship, I liked the man. He had a place in my mind. We had a companionship. We had a brotherhood. We had a depth. We had an embrace. And our embrace and our depth was greater than you find among Israel. And he looks down at me one day. He says, Brother Rob, never forget. He said, if you do that, you will not be my friend. And because of my friendship with him, I wanted to be his friend. I threw it down. I said, I will not do it. Because I valued his friendship above that. I valued his association. Why? Because mommy will watch out for me. When those that thought they were big, I was no chump when it came to throwing hands. I could throw them with the best of them. Yet he was there to guard me as his young brother. He was a little older than me, about 4 years older. He's in his 60s now. And he would protect me. I remember his man owed me, $500. He said, give him his money. And the man said, you have nothing to do with this, TK. We riding on a streetcar in Stuttgart, Germany. This man uncoils himself about 6'8", and he had a minister, and look, he said, give Bro Rob his money now. He said, TK, it's not your business. When he said that, that man broke his hands. He played basketball for UConn. He traveled Europe playing. His hands were like that. And when he came down on that man's face, I'll never forget his name was Tesla. When he came down upside his head, wow! He said, give him his money, wow! Pow! Pow! He tried to bust his head open. I said, TK Lima, it's straight. I said, don't worry about the money. He said, no, Bro Rob. I was at this place one time, and this fellow said, well, I'll do you. And TK said, I'll kill him. And beside us was a manhole about 12 feet. He said, I'm going to throw him in. I said,
DK, you got a present over here, Mary. Come on, let's roll, baby. No, you can't do that. I need you, man. Come on.
And our friendship was built upon such honesty like that. When he left, he ETS before me. All I could do was weep, man. I just cried. We stayed in contact with each other for years. And somehow we just drifted apart. But he was a genuine friend. And he didn't hold nothing back because he was big and he was tall. So he could speak his mind. And I didn't resist him. He was a little older than me. Chase, when I moved to Florida, he received me as his young brother. His mother was a drunkard. He embraced me as the young brother. He never had a brother. He had cousins in Fort Lauderdale. Them boys, everybody knew them. They were hustlers and they would kill you. And it was a pack of them. Them boys moped daddy. They were big men, 6'5", 265 pounds, 3. They were big men. And everybody knew them boys, all of them. It was a caboodle of them. And they were brothers by the mothers that had brothers. Chase never had a brother. And he embraced me as his young brother. You're my brother. And he was a friend. And he warned me, he said, I don't want you to hang with them fellas. Stay away from them. And then when I had nobody to turn to, I went to see him. He said, I told you, don't mess with him. Go take a bath. You got a place here. You know that. That's what a true friend is. Directs us in the pathway of right. It's Yoshua, our friend. He said, I call you no more servants, but friends. Because the servant knows not what the master does. He's our friend. He's telling us about us. Yeah, he's telling you. Hallelujah. There's some things that I want to point out here in the book of Yeshua, in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 13:6, move quickly. Isaiah 13:6, he tells us to yalal or to howl you. He says, for the day of Yah is at hand. He says, going to come as a shoot. Isaiah 13:6, it's going to come as a shoot. It's going to wreak havoc and death and desolation. It's going to bring the ruins. And this day comes from the most powerful when it comes from Yah. That's what it says, doesn't it? I want to drop down immediately to the verse 11. He says, I will punish the world for their evil and the wicked for their iniquity. What is iniquity? One transgressing the Torah. When one defies the Torah, we are people that know what Torah says. He said, I will punish the rich for their wickedness, and I will cause the arrogance of the proud to cease, and I will lay low the haughtiness of the oppressor. He said, I will make a man more precious than the fine gold, even the man than the gold of the wedges of Ophir. You must understand the reason that is in there. I do. One day will understand that. Yah says, therefore, I will shake the heavens. He said, I will shake the olam. He said, the earth shall be moved out of its place. Why? In the wrath of Yah of hosts, and in the day of his fears, his haron, his burning anger, and the day of Yah's great burning, vexing anger. He said, I'm going to cause the earth to be moved. I'm going to cause my wrath, the wrath of Yah. And we find ourselves in one of those categories. Yah commands that we're, Yahshua said, we're in the world, but we're not of the world. If any man love the world, then the love of the Father is not in him. Anything about the world that satisfies you, you want to be a part of that. It makes you think, what am I missing? You're not missing a damn thing. These are the things that we must teach the sons. The older men can't be silly like jackasses and clowns. They must have a beauty about them that the young men inquire their wisdom. They can see it in their pawnee when they come. They can see the excellence of their wisdom in them. You can't find that today. You find the old women, they're silly as hell. They're dumb. They're so juvenile, it's pathetic. So the young daughters don't know what it is to appease a man and to love him and understand the beauty of the comfort of a man and to take care of him. They don't know a damn thing. It's not about the wild thing in the bed. It's not about that. You have nothing special. Every woman got what you got. Every woman.
Why are we men not teaching the young men? Why not the bath teaching the young daughters? You know, Yisrael, when people come, usually I want the Achim to fellowship with them. Very seldom you will find me in the midst of the conversation. Not that I segregate myself from the people. I come, I say something, and I leave it, and I'm gone. But I want them to interact and integrate and talk with each other. But usually I don't spend a lot of time doing that. I really don't. And that's to honor each of them. Because I know they have something that is valuable and pertinent. But that's the way I do things, Yisraya. Because I know I can dominate the scene, the conversation. I don't want to do that. I don't want my words just to speak for me. I want the action of my life to speak. I want my loving, my Ishal to speak. Loving my Achim and the Achutim. It's wrong for me to be unkind to her. And yet I'm kind to this old woman back here. It's wrong. My kindness to her must equal the kindness to her. My kindness to her must equal the kindness to her. My kindness to her must equal the kindness to you. It must be the same. My affection must be the same. My affection for her is to the restraint that it restrains me from going outside of her. And my affection for her, it restrains me for not trying to overcome, pollute her, or take advantage. You've been with me as long as anyone in here beside her. I'm never taking advantage of you. Never. Never, old woman. Never use you. Never try to see how much money I could draw out of you. Never done that. That's what my love should be. Have we ever sat around and laughed and talked? Never. Never. That's respect. That's respect. Never. I have never sat around with her in conversation with men. We laugh and talk. I'm talking to you, woman. Never. I don't care if it was my natural brothers. We didn't go that way. Never. I'm never going that way. Never. There should be a disposition to a strong man. The Torah tells us that the fear of Yahweh Sirach with the faithful, it is birth in the womb. So from the day of conception, he had his hands on me. And no one can deny that. You may, but it's still the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to read this quickly from the book of Baruch. I'm going to close in a moment. First Baruch, listen to this, chapter 4, verse 1. We are the people of the Torah, the nation. And this is what the prophet, the scribe, the writer says in First Baruch 4, 1. He tells us this is the book of commandments of Yah. And the Torah that endures forever, all they that keep it shall come to life. We keep the Torah, we honor what Torah said. We shall come to Chayah, we shall come to the strength of life and the military power. But such as that leave it, they shall die. They shall die, they shall muta. There shall be a premature death. There will be no love for Yah. When we leave the Torah, when our minds are not on the Torah, we give ourselves over unto every kind of unclean, evil thing. Our hearts are open unto every kind of demon. And we'll imagine things that are so vile and so corrupt. It's almost like a man planning his mind with some other outside of the realm of his marriage. And a woman planning her mind with something outside of the realm of her marriage. You know that's wrong, Yisrael. And Yah says, turn you, O Yaakov, and take hold of it. He says, walk in the presence of the light thereof. What light? The light of Torah.
the near. He said, walk in that presence thereof. He said that you may be illuminated. Does not the light illuminate one? So if we're walking, if the Torah is in our minds, does it not illuminate us? I don't care where you go, there's a light that illuminates us, Yisrael. If you got darkness in your mind, your countenance is dark. You look dark. You have the sense of darkness because there's wickedness in us. I don't feel that way about me. When I go places, I want the light. He commands us to let our light so shine that men may see the Tava and the excellent works of the Torah in us. They don't have to know Yah. I let my light shine. The audacity of my light. The hubris of my nature that I know who I am. I know who I am. I know that. And I'm not going to allow anyone to defy that. He tells us a turn that our light may be illuminated, the orb. He says, give not your honor to another, nor the things that are profitable unto you to a strange nation. You don't take the honor that Yah has bestowed upon you because one doesn't receive you that way, you deny that. And here it is that Yah has given us things that we are profitable, that we don't sell out to the nations or to the Goyim. He says this in 1 Baruch 44 and 4. He said, O Yisrael, you're happy. Esha, happy are we. Are we happy? No, we're not happy. He said, happy are we. For the things that are pleasing to Yah are made known unto us. So what I just read today, beginning in Revelation, that has been made known to us, are we happy? Or that's not a happy, happy message? Yeah. See, the things of Yah have been made known to us. Are we happy? Are we happy? Are we filled with the Esha, the riches of Yah's wisdom, His revelation, His knowledge? Are we happy? He said, happy are you, O Yisrael, for the things you did not know that you're falling into a devilish, wicked trap you know now. He said, now you're happy, Yisrael, because those things that are pleasing to Yah, He has made known to you. He said, be of tough cheer, my people. He says, you are the memorial, you are the Zikron, the memorial of Yisrael. He said, you were sold to nations. What people were sold to nations? What people in this nation were sold in this nation? There's only one people of the diaspora that was sold to the nation, and this, that people. He said, you were sold to the nations. And he said, I want you to know something. Not for your destruction. He did not let us go into the hands of the oppressor to be destroyed. And yet we're destroying ourselves, not for your destruction, but because you move Yah to wrath. But because you move the wrath of Yah, he said, you delivered into the hands of your enemy, for you provoked him that made you by sacrifices unto demons. You give our minds over unto folly and jesting. These are demonic powers. You can't mock Yah, Yisrael. You can't do that. He said, you sacrifice to devils and not to Yah. You give time for foolishness and damned folly and clowning, but you don't give time for Huda or Hudu or Yada or Toda. You don't give no praises of Torah in your assembly, your congregations, your gathering, and your conversation. You don't give that to Yah. Because if you did that, then your light or the illuminating of the power of Torah would illuminate you. You give time to fall. You sacrifice to devils and demons. You give your mind over unto unclean things and not over unto the things that are pure. When a man walks with a pure mind, you'll see it. When a daughter of Tizai got the beauty of his pureness, you will see it. Everything you can tell about a man is his ponim. You can tell a lot about a man by his tongue. I was thinking this morning, yesterday, I said, let me look at my tongue. Because when the first thing, when I was growing up, you go to the doctor, they look in your eyes, and they look at your tongue. I don't know if they do that today. Do they still do that? In my day, that's what they did. It's been 35 years, 33 years since I last went to a doctor, so I don't know. With all this technology, they don't have to do that. They get a little DNA, a little sample of your blood, and they take you everything. But they will look in your eyes, and look at your tongue. And you can tell a lot about a tongue of anyone. That's why there's no honor today. That's why the elders, the elderly men, the young men don't honor them because they're clowns.
And the elderly women, the young daughters say, well, she can't tell me. Look at her. It shouldn't be. It should not be. She doesn't know how to love no husband. She doesn't even know how to love hers. What are you talking about, loving a wife? He's mean to his wife. I saw a man that stood right here, talked about how he loved, how he cared. I watched this man this day. I watched him as I was there holding a meeting. The man's wife was in tremendous pain. She says to the man, but yet this man always talked about his daddy knew how to love. His daddy didn't know how to love. Your mom and daddy didn't know how to love. How he loved everyone. I watched this woman in great pain. Her head was throbbing. I felt sorry for her. I watched her say, honey, please, prepare me something. And this damn beast of a bastard said, you get up and do it yourself. I'm not doing nothing. I said, this son of a. And so I could see my issue. I was startled. She said, please. He said, I'm not doing nothing. You do it. You ain't nothing wrong with you. Get up. And so to try to show this man some real affection, I knew she wasn't going to eat anything. I said, my Rafael, can I prepare you a salad? I was hoping she said yes. She said, no, I'll get up and do it because I really, I said, no, let me do it. I'll do it for you. Can I do that for you? She said, well, no. I said, well, can we walk together then? This bastard would not even prepare his wife's plate. And these are my words. I said it to her. I said, when we get back to the hotel, I'm going to crack his ass. I said it that way. I said, I'm going up in that beast with the sword. I'm going to gut him out. And I had every intention to gut him out like a dog. It's going to cut him out. Talk about love. So the last time he was here, I said, no, you don't understand love. Haven't seen him since. He hasn't been back. He wanted to come. I said, nah, you can't come here. I was going to gut him out. I said to her, I said, I'm going to gut him out. I was angry. I said, I'm going to gut this man out. I'm going to run the sword in it. I'm going to gut him out. This beast, this pig, this dog. He loves everyone, and you showed you did your wife like that, you bastard. I'm not one to play with that way. I'm not that way. I'm not phony. You may be. I'm not false. I'm going to make you back up what you say. That wasn't love. I told him, you're disingenuous. You're a hypocrite. Well, you don't know. I said, don't give me your little small talk. I said, there are women that live in New York City. They are having it hard. They got their babies in the midst of the cold. And they're pleasant people. They're nice and they're kind. I said, don't give me no excuse. I said, there are women that are in India poor and they don't complain. I said, you can take that to hell. I said, if you think that I'm going to sympathize with you, you're flat out wrong, man. I said, you will go to hell. I said, because you don't want to deal with your own wickedness. Well, you know, I know Yaz. I said, no, he's not. That's why he let me tell you. You tell me your problems. And I can take you to Philadelphia and show your daughter there that she's striving so hard. She got such pain. She got four little babies, and the only one is 9 years old. She got to get them up every morning to go to work. She doesn't want to be on welfare. She barely makes enough to feed them. Are you going to tell me about your issues, man? All the money you get, all the money you got, and all you got. You going to tell me about that? I say, I will not buy it. I say, if you think I'm going to have some kind of sympathy for you, you can forget that. If you think I'm going to concur with you, you're wrong, man. I don't want to hear your little juvenile ways. That day you showed me when the man I first met him said to my issue over the finish, I says to her, I said, baby, I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. I went back to the bedroom that night, and these were my words. That's Ricky about him three times over. I said, I give him the benefit, though. I know who I'm dealing with. So for a man to call himself teaching someone about the beauty of love, that's not love. Your wife in agony like that? And you can't do that? Hell, that woman to do it just because it's a responsibility. They just do it. The women to do it all the time, there's still no beauty to it because they do it. It's just the truth. There's no love in doing it. They just do it. They just do it. I don't want that. I'm not going to live like that. I'll tell her, bye, you go ahead, baby. Or you want me to leave, makes no difference. I'll leave. But I'm not going to live like that. I'm not going to even subjugate myself that way. That's me. I'm not going to live that way. Because if it's one thing for sure, if it was just about having some physicality, physical sensation, I can go out here and give me another wife, it wouldn't even matter. Just join me with them organizations, you can have four or five of them. Give me a little money. Take care of me a little bit. I will not do that. I don't want no unattractive woman. I don't want her attitude to be vile and stinking. I want a beautiful wife. I don't want him to have a woman who's going to raise hell with him like, no. Who wants that? I want a wife that's beautiful. She has strength. She knows her place. And they must be taught that. This little child must be taught now. And right now. Mama can't wait until she's 15. She's growing every day. There's a song in the days, his name was Louis Armstrong. And he sang the song, What a Beautiful World. He talks about how that the young ones will know much more than he will ever know. She will know more than I will know in many applications of life. She'll know more than her mother will know. The skies are blue, Louis Armstrong. How about you? Everything is made. I'm happy to know that's not how the song goes. But I remember the song. And I say to myself, what a wonderful world. I say to myself, what a wonderful world. We are the pillars of strength, the beauty of a man. There's nothing more beautiful than the charm of a woman. Nothing. I don't care whatever you invest into anything, that's what you're going to get. I invested a lot of time in Garden One this year. We invested money. I leave it in that garden, the beauty of it. And the rain says, we're going to choke out all the life. That's what it did. I'm not the only one that suffered that this year. We are not the only one that suffered that. Man says to me, you can't find one squash on the whole East Coast. None of them made. Too much rain. So what does that do? Make me prepare even more diligently. When I'm overtaken by my own ills, it makes me prepare even greater. I can do all things through Yahshua HaMashiach. I can. And I'm not going to allow anyone to circumvent that. Hallelujah. Let me finish this here. You were sold to nations, not for your destruction, but because you moved y'all to wrath.
You were delivered into the enemies, for you provoked him by making sacrifices to devils, show them they're not to Yah. Verse 8, you have forgotten the everlasting about Yah that brought you up. He says, you have grieved Yerushalayim that nursed you. We know that Yerushalayim is the city where Shalom is taught. We don't want Yah to teach us the Shalom of his discipline. And then he says in verse 19, it says, for when that city saw the wrath of Yah, the nurturing, when she saw the wrath of Yah come upon you, she said, listen, Yisrael, hearken, Shema, O you that dwell in Zion, Yah has brought upon me great mourning. When you see one that is not operating in the beauty of Yerushalayim, the spirit of Shalom, you should weep. You should cry. Because you know what the agony is. It's the wrath of Yah. And for us to be, we are a nation, and I'm talking to you that are listening, those that were here, and us here as well. We are people that's so insensitive. We don't give a flat out with a damn. If it's one thing I always wanted, because I wanted it. I wanted to be loved. I wanted to understand the beauty of love. And so my deduction of what love was, I wanted to intrigue all men and everyone that way. I wanted to be loved. I want to be kind. I want to consider my ach, my achot. I want to do that. You may not. I do. I'm not a hypocrite. That's one thing. I'm not a hypocrite. I may be ignorant. I won't fight you on that one. An unlearned man. But I'm not a hypocrite. You think I'm one because you're a hypocrite. You think I'm unfair because you're unfair. You think I don't care because you don't care. You don't give a damn. Well, he's got tough love. What is tough love? Mama, both of y'all are old. Was your mother ever tough with you? You thought she was tough? Was your mother tough with you? Huh? Sure she was. You think that when these little gals right here get out of hand, I say, okay, that's it. Here. You better call Zakiya. I say, here, call your mama. Or the whole attitude change. Please. Okay, I'll do right, Papa. Okay. Don't make me. Here it is. You want me to call her? They know. Oh, Sarah, I will literally start crying at that. That's okay. That's it. I'm calling her right now. So here's the... No, Bobby, please. Oh, God, you're right. Do you think they understand what tough love? That's no such thing as tough love. That's just the integrity of love. Are we the children of Yah? Does he love us? Does he correct us? Does he chasten us? Sure he does. This is how we got this damn warped sensation of what we think love is. We got this warped sensation of what love is. You love the daughters. You love the sons. You're walking away in a discipline that they will be impressed. I don't care whether you're in the bean field or you're cutting wood. Even these Achim said that they would hire me. Cutting those trees down. I said, will you hire me on? They said, we'll take you. All right. They will not be disappointed. They will not be disappointed. They will not be disappointed if they brought me along. And if we had my friend here in greatest strength, I would go out with them and help them. I would. I got a soul over there. Yeah, that's my personal soul. She's bad to the bone. I had to go all the way to North Carolina to find that soul. Can find them now. That one soul costs nearly $1,000. But she cuts wood too. I like the way she sounds. She sits down like a Cadillac. I don't want the millions LeBron James got. I want the riches that are greater than his riches.
I don't want the accolades of his wealth or his house. I wish I had some. I don't want that. That little shack, I can do the things I need to do. I can eat, I can sleep, and I can drop it. These are the things that bring the wrath of Yah. For when she saw the wrath of Yah coming, she listened. And when we gather here on the Shabbat, we should listen to say, Yah, we're in Yerushalayim. And we should mourn and cry before him. You don't find that today, Yisrael. You find a hostile attitude. You find a mindset that is so corrupt and so wicked. And that's just the truth. I want to read one more verse and I'm going to close. There's much more to this. I've got 50, 60 scriptures. Man, I didn't realize I had so much. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I don't know what I want to read. This is the last one I'm going to read. It's from the book of Job, Job 21:17. This is this great intriguing of Job with Zophar, Job 21:17. The question of Job, he said, how often or oft is the near the candle of the wicked put out? And we know as Yisra'iyah, as a nation, there should be no candle of wickedness in us. For we know that the mitzvah of Yah is our near. It is a lamp. And the Torah is light. We know that. And we know that when we are corrected, reproof of instruction, that is the way of light. So he asked the question, how often is the candle of the wicked put out? How often comes their destruction upon them? He distributes sorrows in his anger. That's what Yah does. In his wrath, he caused sorrows to fall upon the people. He said they are stubble before the wind. And they are chaff before the storm as the storm carries it away. You have said that Yah lays up his iniquity for his children. He lay up your iniquity for his children. He rewards him. He shall know it. Then he says his eyes shall see his deeds, his calamity, his destruction. And he shall drink of the wrath of Almighty Yahweh, the most powerful. There's the wrath, and the Torah talks about those four words in that sequential path, the wrath of Yah. Well, who is that for? I want to read this before I close. I want to show you who the wrath of Yah is for. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. From 2 Melachim, 2 Kings 22:13. When any man reads this book, and any bath of Tizion, you gather daughters of Tizion, men, there should always be a constant awareness and a reminder of Yah. You should never be overtaken in any zeal or zest to pursue anything that draws you, whereby your conversations, your attitude gets so far away from Yah that you become so bizarre in your approach. That's wickedness. But this is what Yoshiah says here in 2 Kings 22:13. As he inquired of Yah, as he sought Yah after the reading or the hearing of the Torah, he says, go you. He says, I want you to darash. I want you to inquire of Yah for me. This is the Melach saying this. He says, for the people and for all Yehuda concerning. It did not say just the Dabar, but the Dabarim. He says the words of this book that is found. Should not we be concerned about all the words of this book? That's what he said. I read you words out of the book, didn't I? He said concerning the words of this book, of this book. He says, for great, that's what he says, for great is the wrath, the hammer, the rage. For great is the wrath of Yah that is kindled against us. Why? Because our avad have not listened to the words of this book. Have we listened to the word of this book? We don't listen to it. Great is his wrath against us because we that are the Zachini, the older ones, we have not listened. So how do we expect someone else to listen? Our attitude is piss poor. It stinks. It's vile.
is wicked. That the putrefying scent that come up out of us, it stinks unto the depths of hell. It's a raw stench. And we think we're sweet. You're not sweet. He said, because we have not listened to the word of this book, listen, what to do to Asa, to fashion ourselves according, does it say to some or all that? All that is written concerning us. So what I read in Gilyana, is that concerning us? Should we not fashion ourselves all that concern us? What I read in Colossia, should we not concern ourselves? What I read in Ephesians, should not we, with the foolish gesturing and the talk of damn stupidity and folly, should we not? This concerns us, Yisrael. And this is our shape. And the wrath of Yah is going to be revealed against us for our damn folly and our foolishness. We can continue to think we're getting by, but you're not getting by. Be not deceived. Yah's not mocked. Whatsoever man sows, that shall he also reap. This is what our forefathers did, and we're procuring that upon, they procured that upon us. And you're doing it to the babies, the one that suck your titty, one that is in your womb. When a father hates Yah, he will send the curse upon the children out of the third and fourth generation. When a man's house is not in order according to the complicit order of Torah, he's a man that hates Yah. There's nothing more despicable than a weak man and a cowardice of a man. And there's nothing more vile than a bodacious Jezebel that rise up. Rise up against me. I will kill you. I mean that. I mean it. That's a fact. So where are the men? They're cowardly and they're weak. They don't know how to say that's wrong. Well, they come. No, you're wrong. Fat out. You do right. I don't care what anyone else says. I'm going to do right. I'm going to stop that. May the riches of Yah rest upon you. There's much. As my Zach and Yaramiah would say, there's much more to this. I just couldn't complete it. Didn't go the way I wanted it, but that's all right. You've been warned. You've been warned. You've been warned, just like Yoshaya. When he heard the reading of the Torah, he said, he called the messengers of Yah, go inquire of Yah. Tell me what this book, bring revelation of this. We are jackasses and dumb as hell because we don't want to know what the book says. We want to hear some clown folly and jiving and shuck. Bucking, clowning like jackasses. Men want to act like little perverted punkish boys. The women want to act like big stud bull daggers clowning. See these old silly women today? They're silly. I can't say it about all women. I'm not stereocasting on women like that. They're women that you see that have a beauty of decent. You can see it in them. And I've seen them. They have a beauty of decent. And I see it in them. You can tell. And I'm talking about women that don't even know Yah. They have more decency than the women that call themselves knowing Yah. They have a beauty of decency. They have a charm about them. And you can tell it's a beautiful charm. It's a beautiful charm. And that's just a fact. I'm talking about us as false damn pretenders and false. And say we love Yah and we don't give a damn about each other. You love someone, you show them what's right. You teach them what's right. You love me, teach me what's right. Show me what's right. Instruct me what's right. Yah loves us, doesn't he? Did he not instruct us in his book? Yeah. All right, then. That's what you need to do. If we think Yah's going to tolerate our folly, you're wrong. And what we sow, we got to reap it. May the riches of Yah rest upon you, Yisra Yah. You that are listening, send an offering, send a gift to help. You're stingy as hell. You sit there and you're blessed. Don't tell me you don't have the money. Stop going to damn Walmart and Dollar Mart. Quit being so greedy. Stop eating the fat back and the chitlins and send a dollar. That's what you do. Stop eating like a hog. Get off your lazy backside and get out and walk some. And send that money you will buy the damn cookies and the cupcakes with. So may Yah bless you all in Yeshua's name. Yah bless you. Shalom, Yisrael. Yeah, brother. Tomorrow, time of fellowship.
beautiful Shabbat, whereby his mercies, his Ahava, his Hasid, been poured out upon Yisrael. You know, there's one thing, there's a statement that Dawid prayed that he said unto to Yah. He said, as a righteous man, a Sadiq man, an orderly man, if he strike me, he hits me. See, we allow the wicked to beat us up, and we don't say anything. We don't do anything against that, Yisrael. But we want to fight against the Sadiq man, the righteous man, when they smite, when they rebuke, when they hit me. Dawid says, it should be an excellent oil unto me. The bruising, it heals. It comforts. It smooths out the rough places, the rough patches in my life. Hallelujah. And he said that the smiting, it does not break my head. Hallelujah. Our head should be Yahshua HaMashiach. We should smash that head of our old flesh, Yisrael, of the old serpent. The flesh should be impaled daily. So he intends for that head to be crushed, to be smashed, but not the head of Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. So a message like that should be a blessing unto us, Yisrael. It should strengthen us, set us aright. We have veered off the beaten path, and Yahshua HaMashiach has laid out the path for Yisrael. So let us continue in the Ahava of Yah and his Torah and his Mishvah, that we should be an excellent blessing, an excellent people unto Almighty Yahweh this day. Hallelujah. Let's stand to our feet, Yisrael. Hallelujah. We told Yah for all things. Hallelujah. Let's turn to Yerushalayim. Abba Yahweh, we told you for another beautiful day you have made. Abba Yahweh, a day in which your mercies, your Ahava have been renewed upon the house of Yisrael. We do ask your blessings upon Yisrael that are scattered abroad throughout the Olam, the four corners, Abba Yahweh. You know who they are, Abba Yahweh. Touch them and heal them, Abba Yahweh. Bring us back, Abba Yahweh, to the place that you desire us to be in these last days, Abba Yahweh. We do ask your Melechim to be a camp about those that have come from near and afar, Abba Yahweh. And again, Abba Yahweh, touch us and bring us together, Abba Yahweh, as a people unto you, that we may lift up your name amongst any circumstance, Abba Yahweh, and above all things. We do barak you in the precious name of Yahshua HaMashiach, we do declare, hallelujah. 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 Yabarak ko Yisrael. Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom.